Good afternoon, welcome, and welcome to the Age of Ransom. Let me paint a picture for you. It's Monday morning, you come into the office, you check your email, you open some attachments, and then you see this on your screen. Your stomach drops to the floor. Oh boy, you're now a victim of ransomware. Now, you may think just for yourself, it may not be that bad. Hopefully, I have some backups. Maybe I lose some work I did over the weekend. Maybe if I'm a security person, I'll go and try to reverse the malware. But then your phone starts ringing. You pick up the phone. And what happens is you find out that your entire company has been hit by ransomware. So now you realize, what do I do for the company? Your phone rings again, you pick it up, and this time it's your CEO, and he invites you to come up to the boardroom and talk about how the entire company is now shut down for business. And also he asked, what exactly is Bitcoin? How do we get that thing? So this may be an isolated incident. Maybe some of you experienced it yourself, but this is not isolated, and it's occurring at a rapid pace. So let me talk about a few examples from this. There's a university in Canada. At the beginning part of this year, they got hit by ransomware. Their entire network was held hostage. So what did they do? They had to get back. So they paid $20,000 to open up their network. So certainly the business disruption to the university was something that they had to contend with. But what did this prove? It proved that the criminal business model for ransomware works. It works. They can attack from remotely, they can encrypt from remotely, and they can monetize their ransom remotely as well. But it's not just about business disruption. How about patient or loss of life? That's why hospitals are now a big target as well. Earlier this year in Los Angeles, California, a hospital was hit by ransomware. The entire network was shut down. They had to physically move patients to other facilities. They had to bring out those fax machines, take the dust off of them, and conduct business via fax. So when it comes to patient or loss of life or critical infrastructure, that's a lot more than business downtime. This hospital also paid the ransom. And it's not just about consumers, your IT users, or industries. It's also could be whole countries. In January of this year, there was only one recorded case of ransomware in Singapore. In March, 155. And it's increasing. So countries and cities that are digitally advanced, that they're being more mobile, more connected, more IT services, they're outpacing the ability for security to keep up. So what we think of ransomware, that is only one attack vector. This is about the age of ransom. So some of those examples were around end user workstations. Maybe consumer at home, your parents, one of your business users. From there, it becomes a toehold and takes out entire networks and systems like the hospital and the university. But it's not just there. It could be entire websites. There's vulnerabilities in WordPress that you can attack remotely, encrypt the content database, websites offline. What if that was your e-commerce gateway or your online bill pay system? That changes how you do business. And then ultimately, we believe data is the crown jewels. The ability for ransom adversaries to take your data and ransom them to get it back. This is not just the future, this has already happened. 2 years ago, Domino's Pizza had their customer data stolen. What's interesting is Domino's refused to pay. Maybe they didn't get it within 30 minutes. Do they still have that guarantee? But Domino's did not pay the ransom. Maybe their business value of the data wasn't enough. Or maybe they stood up and refused to be extorted. In this case, there wasn't enough of a criminal business model to realize from data held at ransom. I think that's going to change, and we're going to see a lot more data ransom attacks. RFPs, maybe it's an oil well on how effective that is. Maybe it's a new business model a company wants to do. Or maybe it's your health record, and you don't want that to get out into the public. So how are security professionals looking to defend their organization? So certainly, we have and know that we need to prevent as much as possible. It could be the easiest way to stop attacks. Prevent at the perimeter. Prevent at the endpoint. Prevent at the server. But certainly, we know that attacks can change. They can morph, and you may and will get hit by a ransom attack. So you need to restore as much as possible. Good backups, maybe not backups that attach to your network file server, because they may get encrypted as well. Good backups, cloud-based backups, those type of things. But ultimately, as security professionals, we do want to protect our environment. We want to make security a foundational component of our IT and application infrastructures. But we struggle with that every day, because the protect model is a bit broken. You may have heard this yourself. Security is an afterthought. There's a business project. They're pushing forward. They want to get it out there. Oh, whoops, we forgot about security. So maybe at the end, they want to bolt something on, right? So once you bolt on security and you create this Frankenstein of security things, and at the same point, security is not about a tech or a tool, right? It's about people, and it's about process to put those together. So what models are working from a protection point of view? So the Cloud Security Alliance did a survey last year, and they asked IT leaders, not security people, IT leaders, and they asked, what do you think about cloud-based security? 65% of IT trust the cloud as much or more than premise solutions. What does that tell you? The cloud is more secure, they have less trust and confidence with your on-premise, but this is a model, an architecture, and a blueprint that is proving to make security foundational. So where many of the cloud projects, cloud first, cloud migration can be driven by the business line, a financial benefit, no CapEx, IT gets the scalability. IT gets the ability to get more computing or less computing depending on the usage, more availability for the resources. This has created a whole industry and a whole paradigm called DevOps, where development and operations has a seat at the table with the cloud architecture. Things like CI/CD, continuous integration, continuous deployment, they can help influence the IT architecture, the application architecture, to get part of that. This cloud architecture blueprint is also a way for security to have a seat at the table. Make sure that security is built in as a foundational component, as a first-class citizen in your IT and application infrastructure. The industry is calling that DevSecOps. I think we need our own new term, like Ninja Security Cloud or something really cool, but we'll take DevSecOps because people know what DevOps is. And how can we make that easy to use? The concept of security as a service. To make security so easy to use, to embed, for application and developers to use it as easy it is to use any programming language. So I'll give you some examples for that. There's a payment processing company called Stripe. They're in the new fintech space. And they have the ability for application developers to add payment processing services to their websites or their mobile applications. And they can take credit cards in multiple currencies and multiple countries. They make adding payment processing for DevOps as easy as a service. But Stripe realized in order to get market adoption, they had to make security a first-class citizen. Stripe calls it seamless security. So there's five lines of code that application developers can put into their e-commerce website to accept credit card payments. Security is built into that. Encryption is built into that. Two-factor and multi-factor authentication is built into it. Stripe themselves are a level one PCI certified vendor. And more importantly, using this cloud service, no customer credit card data stays on your servers. So for a security team to partner with DevOps and help them select the right cloud business services so security is built in, then that is a big win. In fact, if anything, the business team is actually paying for this service, so you get security that doesn't hit your budget. So Gartner, a leading IT and analyst firm, always comes out with their top 10 strategic technology trends. This is from this year. They came out the first part of the year. The top technology trends this year are things like 3D printing, artificial intelligence, Internet of Things, these really cool things. One security trend made the list, top 10 list. We in this room may have hoped for two or three or four, but we got one. And Gartner calls it adaptive security architecture. And that's important for a couple of reasons. They understand that you need to take an architecture approach to security. And it needs to be adaptive because the threat landscape will change. The adversary tactics will change. So Gartner describes adaptive security architecture. Once again, this is a statement toward their IT leaders, not security. IT leaders must focus on detecting and responding to threats, as well as more traditional blocking. So that changes the model on how we do protection. Make the concept of protection a first-class citizen. Build it into the foundational layer of your IT and application services, and change it from a point in time into a continuous delivery model. Just like DevOps has continuous integration and delivery, security can have a continuous security solution. And part of that needs to have visibility, monitoring, and response. The visibility so you can actually see your assets in your environment, to have a global asset database that is up to date. Which assets are performing what function? What software packages do they have on those? What hardware systems do they have? And even identify shadow IT. Continuous monitoring so you can have an up-to-date picture of the security profile of that asset. Is it vulnerable? Does it have the latest patches? Is there a configuration that's been changed? Does it have a cross-site scripting, that real-time and up-to-date monitoring? And then, ultimately, the ability to respond to that. Patch a vulnerability, revert a configuration file. So in the Verizon Data Breach Report last year, 95% of the exploits correlate down to 10 CVE vulnerabilities. Just 10. Some of them are from 2014. So to get a real-time posture of your assets, how they're vulnerable, and how can you patch them, makes this continuous security solution as part of your foundational layer. So let's get started. We're here to learn. We're here to do. Now, certainly, this assumes that you have a view of your asset inventory, that you have a governance model in place, you have a risk model, an audit, and also a response framework. So your environment may be as complicated as this. You have cloud projects or cloud-first projects. You have cloud migration projects and also on-premise or legacy architectures, which you can't change. So where DevOps now has a seat at the table, and part of their charter is to assist and educate the business. Go cloud, cloud-first. Security can have that same seat at the table. Encourage cloud-first projects. Encourage it in a test cycle or in a small pilot. And that makes you part of that foundational architecture. for those cases where a line of business is looking to migrate from the cloud. Step right up. Be part of that conversation. In fact, you want to have them migrate to the cloud because then you'll be able to build in security capabilities as part of the architecture that maybe weren't there as part of the on-premise solution. And then, of course, those on-premise applications. They may always be there. We don't have the opportunity to only start the companies we work for in the cloud. So you have to have a solution and a capability that gives you that continuous visibility, monitoring, and response for your on-premise architecture as well. And ideally, holistically, across all of those application silos. Leading cloud providers have built security into their platforms. They've built in identity and access management, encryption, DDoS mitigation. They've built it into their platforms. They've also opened up the third-party software vendors, opened up their platforms with APIs. So as part of Amazon Web Services or Google or Microsoft, you can add vulnerability management very easily through their management dashboards. You can add compliance solutions. You can add web application security, make it a foundational component for cloud projects. Migration is possible. It's not for just small companies with one or two people. Large companies are doing it. So here's an Amazon case study for a company called Expedia. They're an online travel company. You can book hotels and flights and rental cars. Maybe some of you have used Expedia to travel here today. Expedia had a service called Expedia Suggest Service. When you're typing your destination, it dropped down a list of locations so you can easily select it. When Expedia first launched this, it was from their data center in the US. They were getting 700 millisecond response times to all of their users. And their business people said, that's just not fast enough. People are going to go somewhere else. So the line of business said, we need to move to the cloud. DevOps and security were part of that discussion. So they migrated to the cloud. They used Amazon. They went from one company-owned data center in the US to global Amazon AZs. One here in Singapore to serve Asia, two in the US for North America and South America, and one in England to serve Europe. That 700 millisecond response time was reduced to less than 10 milliseconds. Customer usage, ticket orders, volume went up. They were able to do it very, very quickly. They were able to conceive, build, and deploy this in Amazon in less than 3 months. So security people, when you hear 3 months, they left something out, didn't they? Well, in this case, they did not leave out security. They used Amazon's native identity and access management as part of this project. Developers, sysadmins, IT auditors had identity access management, two-factor authentication as part of this project. It's easy to think you take an application you own, you put it into the cloud, you get rid of control. By using Amazon's native identity access management, they were able to build it in from the ground up. And of course, because Amazon has open partnerships with companies, you can imagine that Expedia can add vulnerability management and compliance solutions and web application security. So migration is possible. We have entered the age of ransom. This new threat vector will change how companies need to defend themselves. Those that don't will see a business disruption that hasn't been seen in the industry before. There is a way forward. There's a way for security professionals to make security a business conversation, a first-class citizen. Build it into the application and IT infrastructure. Add continuous monitoring, visibility, and response to your architecture. So for those that do, they are now better protected to defend themselves as we move through the age of ransom. Make security that first-class citizen and be enabler to speed the way to new business achievements for your company. Thank you.